He was a hottie. I've been in love with him since I was in the sixth grade. You know, I thought, this is my destiny. This is the person I'm supposed to be with. I never would have thought that anything bad could happen. You just think that it's a happily ever after. Everybody thinks that. It wasn't too long into our marriage where we realized that was not the case.
I was still very independent in my behavior. You know, sort of lived the way I lived as a single person.
Alan was working for the church. He was very involved. Of course, we had two young children, so I had to stay home with them. So I kind of felt abandoned. I was looking for somebody to love me for me. Someone calls, and it's somebody that I, you know, had a relationship with. One small talk led to more talk, and, you know, that led to a meeting, and then it lasted for 14 months. I think it was just the darkness that I had never really gotten rid of, being sexually molested as a child. So I thought, from that point forward, this is what I'm supposed to be. I'm supposed to be a pleaser of men. Of course, that's messed up thinking, but you know, that's what happens whenever, at an early age, something so detrimental happens in your life. It was just something that took hold, and I never could just jerk myself out of it. I never wanted to be truthful with myself as to who I was and what I'd become. So I would pray to God, I want out, but I don't know how to get out. And He kept opening doors, but those doors were always for me to tell the truth. And that was the one thing I never could do, because I thought, I don't want to hurt Alan.
I had enough information that I was ready to confront her. I wanted Lisa to tell the truth. Finally, when she broke emotionally, when she told the truth, my first feeling was not anger, was not resentment, it was relief. All of a sudden, it was like, the truth is out there. At that point, I was like, I don't want you here. I don't want you in our house. I don't want to sleep in the same bed with you. But for the future, I don't know. We're gonna have to see.
My whole life had been built around Alan. I think all that I had actually done was to make Alan the Lord of my life. I didn't have a relationship with God. I'd just been sitting on a pew for 15 years, listening, but nothing ever penetrated. Nothing ever went into my heart and changed my heart. I have nothing. Without God, I have nothing. I finally just went and said, God, You're all I have. What I need to do, show me how to get past this. I had a group of ladies that I studied with. About 3 weeks into it, I said, you know what? I don't think I have God's Spirit. I think that's what's missing here. I read that the way for me to get God's Spirit was for me to be baptized. So me and that group of ladies went to a pool, and I was baptized. I put it all out there on the line. I took that shame, and I laid all of it at the foot of the cross, and Christ took it. And I felt relief from all these burdens, from all the problems that I'd had. Being molested, I felt just an immediate washing of all of that. At that point, I thought, I can do anything. Even if Alan and I don't get back together, even if I lose that relationship, I still have my relationship with Christ.
She was finally doing it for the right reasons in her relationship with God, separate from me. I saw in her a true life change, I mean, an inner life change that she went through when she really made Jesus her Lord. When we made the decision to get back together, I didn't want to do it flippantly. Okay, move on back, everything's great. I knew this had to be a moment for us. And we basically had a vow renewal, but it was personal, it was private, it was just the two of us. And we got new rings, and then we started our life again as husband and wife.
That was probably the one greatest gift that I've ever received, His forgiveness.
It was very raw at the time. It was very tough. Every day I didn't wake up feeling like, oh, I'm the best, I'm forgiving. It took a lot of growth, and it took a lot of love, and it took a lot of time to live that forgiveness out.
It is shameful, the things that I've done in my life, but that shame does not define me. The thing that defines me is forgiveness and grace and just being the woman that I need to be, a Christian and godly wife and woman and mother and grandmother and friend.
And God has put us in a position now of we're on national television, you know, we're writing books, we're all over the place. All of a sudden, you realize that, you know, we're in this place I never could have imagined us being.
The relationship we have now is something that I never could have imagined us having. I wake up every day and think, could I love this man anymore? And the next day I wake up and I love him more than I did the day before. That's just God, and he gives us that. He gives us the ability to love exponentially, more than we ever thought we could. I'm praying that there's marriage in heaven. I want to be married to him
Jesus
forever.
I told her said there wasn't, but you know, she's still hoping that maybe he'll change his mind.
I'm still asking God to change his mind.
She's thinking maybe he'll change his mind by the time we get there. I don't know.